pastor here at Calvary by the Sea, and my pronouns are he, him, and his. And it's good to be with you. Love. Love, love, love. This beautiful four-letter word. It's so fascinating, so riveting. It has numerous variations, multiple adaptations. It has countless emotions and feelings and actions attached to it. We kiss and hug that which we love. We linger a little longer with those who we love. We sacrifice ourselves for those that we love. And we embrace those we love just the way they are. Have you ever noticed how love is not so easily defined? And oftentimes Brenda asks me, do you love me? Well, that's the easy part. Of course I love you. The challenge comes when she asks me the follow-up question. Why do you love me? And right there, in that very moment, I am caught up with wanting to say the right thing. You understand? But I find myself saying so many things. How can I fit my love into one reason? After all 30 years of being with Brenda, she's my best friend, she's my partner, she's my teammate. We hang out together, we get in trouble together. We invest in things, in our children, in God's way in the world. We invest in the church. We invest into God's creation. This much I do know, though. We are all made to love and to be loved. In fact, this is not even my opinion. This is just a biological, scientific fact. I mean, consider this. After birth, a baby's brain, its development improves with the mere physical touch of the mother. Scientists have discovered an increase in cognition, in resilience of the baby's brain, from a simple physical touch of the mother. Hear me. A baby separated from the mother's physical touch will suffer brain development. So when I say we are made to love and to be loved, it is so much more than a theological statement, so much more than a Christian slogan. It is a biological reality. Love is not only a divine commandment, but also an organic human need. We all need to love and to be loved. In fact, there was a Scientific Daily pre-pandemic article that was offered. They offered a study that the University of Michigan provided that further gave us understanding to this power of love. Apparently, the study demonstrated just how powerful the effect is upon children when parents love each other. It profoundly shapes the future of children. The research shows that when parents love each other, children end up staying in school longer, and they end up marrying later in life. It is to say that parents that love one another greatly affect the future of their children, amounting to a robust educational career and less likely to escape into their own marriage. Often children view their parents as role models and take longer to seek similar marriages. You see, the point is this, friends. Love is not irrelevant. It makes an enormous difference from infancy to childhood to adulthood. All of our variations of how we love have a significant consequence. The measure of our love affects those around us, especially our children. And in a year where our congregation has prioritized children, teens, young people, I believe our love for these generations matter. It too has a consequence. So I ask, what is your measure of love? What is the measure of love that you have? How are you enjoy practicing love. In fact, if Jesus asked you this morning, do you love me? What would be your response? And certainly this is the premise of today's wisdom. However, before going there, let us reminisce a little bit about Peter. This is his full circle moment, after all. Back at the shoreline, fishing again, as it seems and appears like he has returned to his day job after the death and resurrection of Jesus. If you remember, at the shoreline, fishing is where Jesus encounters Peter for the first time. But this Peter is not the same Peter, friends. He has now walked on water, he has been rebuked, he has received the foot washing, has denied Jesus, and even has run to the tomb. A roller coaster of life, with ups and downs of human living, but despite all of that, Jesus still offers Peter his heart. Moreover, there is this subtle motif to this whole encounter. There are three questions about love that are somehow pinned up next to the three times Peter denied Jesus. Notice there is no forgiveness conversation between Jesus and Peter. There's no shaming, no blaming, no excuses, no rationale. Instead, a common agreement to move forward for the sake of the world. Jesus just needs Peter to be the shepherd. Jesus just needs Peter to care for the sheep, to protect the sheep from the evil. He just wants Peter to care for the abundant life of the sheep. But there is more to this wisdom. It is such a mystical encounter between Peter, the disciples, and the resurrected Jesus. It all commenced by an invitation to eat breakfast together, grilled fish and bread. Does this sound familiar at all? It is the same foods that fed the 5,000. Nonetheless, one must be reminded that this story, at this point, Jesus has already appeared to his disciples in Jerusalem in the upper room, and a second time to the doubting Thomas, and now here in Galilee. But why a third appearance, guys? This is a group of disciples that already have the Holy Spirit. They have already been sent out into the world for a mission. Why an added appearance? Why does Jesus need to show up again? See, perhaps Jesus is doing what he said he would do. Jesus promised to be with them always, present and providing. And simply put, Jesus is being food and nourishment, presence and provision. He is being the life-sustaining source for his beloved. You know, it's clear. The disciples weren't confident or secure in themselves, evident by their inability to address him, even though they knew it was him. Surely they are still dependent on him.
As Scripture says, apart from him, they can do nothing. They needed Jesus' continued presence, Jesus' continued provision. They needed his words, his call. This moment is also a declaration that Jesus' life and resurrection did not end on Sunday morning or on Easter morning. Rather, it's an ongoing, day after day, time after time, the life-sustaining work of resurrection continues to this very day. And this is the promise for us today, friends. Jesus is our sustaining presence, our provider as well. Jesus is our food and nourishment as well. He continues to care for us, to feed us, to protect us. And we know this very well. And the simple answer to all the three questions is, yes, I love you, like Peter said. But the challenge is the follow-up question. Why? Why do you love me? See, I think this is where I want to pause for a bit and ask us, why do we love Jesus? I think it's a really good question for today's sermon. Why do we love Jesus? Because oftentimes I see that we tend to cope and tend to believe that we can care for ourselves. Oh, I don't need Jesus' provision. I don't need Jesus' presence. I don't need Jesus to nourish me or feed me. I've got everything I need. And if we're honest about many of these things, it's that we need Jesus' presence in everything. We need Jesus' presence in the lives of our children. We need Jesus to nourish our teens. We need Jesus to nourish our relationships, our marriages, our partnerships. We need the sustenance, the life-sustaining source to be in the midst of our world where there is pain today. We need the presence of Jesus. Where genocide is being committed, we need the presence of Jesus. Where there is inequality and oppression and exploitation, there we need the presence of Jesus. And yet, we move around this world thinking we can feed ourselves. We're capable of nourishing ourselves. And perhaps the beginning point for loving Jesus, or why to love Jesus, is to recognize and admit that we need Jesus in our lives. We need, like the disciples, sustenance, words, life, nourishment, presence. But perhaps it's not part of our American culture. Perhaps we've fallen into the rest of the world and we just think we've got to do it ourselves. We don't need someone else. We can figure it out. And yet, here it was again, the disciples realized, no matter if we have the Holy Spirit, no matter if we have this mission, we still need Jesus in our lives. Sure, the "Do you love me?" questions were directed to Peter, absolutely. But I believe they were meant for all the disciples who were hearing that day, and even for this group of disciples in this room. Jesus asks us this morning, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? All of these "do you love me" questions are actually the guide for the future. Jesus wanted his disciples to do everything from agape love. Agape, the ancient word for Greek word for love, it is known as this sacrificial love, as this divine love, a love that is concerned for the well-being of neighbor, regardless of identity, race, or religion. It is the highest form of love. Did you think? The highest. This is the love that Jesus wants for his sheep. This is the kind of love that he wants for Peter. This is the kind of love Jesus wants for us. Everything must derive from this kind of love, from grace, because that is what Jesus offers us over and over again. In fact, he circles back around to offer us love and grace, even when we reject it. No matter what we have said or what we have done, no matter how we are feeling this morning, the train of grace is coming back around, inviting us to get on, to enter into the flow. You see, I wonder if this morning could be our full circle moment. I know many of you are longtime churchgoers, longtime members, longtime followers of Jesus. But can you remember the first time you heard about Jesus? The first time you encountered the undeniable love of God? The first time you felt the grace of God just shower over you? Or the first time you experienced a miracle from the divine? Can we let this moment be our recommitment to being witnesses of God's love for the sake of the world? See, I know this sounds like a daunting task. How can we witness to the love of God and allow it to repair the world? Is it even possible? Yes, it's possible. I've seen it firsthand. I've heard of it firsthand. I've seen it in this congregation's radical hospitality and welcome. I've seen it in the faces of people in Skid Row among the largest houseless population in America. I've seen it in the living rooms of hospice patients as the family gathers for those final moments. I've heard it in the stories of queer and trans people finding healing and redemption and reconciliation. I've experienced it in prayer circles among immigrant and migrant people as they shared how God protected them through their journey. I've heard it in the stories of women who gained equity and justice and liberation. I've heard it in the stories of my Black and brown and indigenous people of color. You see, love, agape love, is not only possible, but it is slowly healing the entire world. But I also believe that our humanity, our churches, must participate in such things. How can the world know about this inclusive, radical, and hospitable love without us? We are of this world. We are in the grocery stores, in the restaurants, in the schools, in our neighborhoods. We are in our jobs, among the people, among the society. We are the ones who are tasked with being witnesses of this agape love. You know what I say sometimes? I think that Jesus is true reason for showing up a third time to Peter. And so to remind him of his true calling. Yes, Peter was a fisherman by day, but his true calling was to be a shepherd. Sometimes we lose our way and we need Jesus to call us back. I received a call a couple weeks ago from ChurchWide. If you don't know what ChurchWide is, it is our church headquarters for the ELCA in Chicago. And this friend who sits alongside the national presiding bishop of the entire thing, the one that sees the entire ELCA, you know, 10,000 congregations, right? The church is in crisis. Those were the words by my friend. We have 7 seminaries across the nation and only 6 students enrolled for the fall. Hear me. We have more seminaries than students who want to be pastors. The ELCA has 16,000 rostered ministers. 8,500 of those are retired, with many more to come this year. There are more churches than pastors. Our current pastors need to share the ministry, to empower others to lead and serve, especially young people. How else will they sense a calling to ministry if they are not practicing the ministry? Now, that in itself is troubling. But what is even more troubling, in my opinion, is the widespread lack of vibrancy, lack of growth, lack of development among our existing churches. I was approached in this same phone call to present to ChurchWide on a new initiative around multi-ethnic and intersectional ministry and growth. CDTS has been selected as one of the flagship churches among the 20 across the nation that are doing the hard work of church vitality, church growth, and development among existing churches. They are doing the hard work of engaging young people, young families, people of color, the queer community, and this generation of humans who have preconceived notions of the church and its leaders. And I, for one, friends, completely understand these dynamics and beliefs. The American Christian Church has stood on the wrong side of history for way too long. It is time to right the wrongs. It is time to stand for the oppressed, for the exploited, the abused, and the mistreated. It is time to speak up when injustice happens in our country and in our world. It is time to acknowledge the trauma, the pain, the injustice that the church has historically perpetrated and perpetuated. It is time to do the right thing, admit our wrongs, apologize, and do better. I believe this is another compelling reason why to love, why to be witnesses of God's love through Jesus, why we must act as shepherds in this world. Because you do realize that Jesus said to Peter, "Feed my people." In the ancient Greek, basko, which means to feed, to nourish, spiritually, and the word koimaino, which means to supervise, to guard, and to guide. So we, the people gathered by the divine, to respond to the cries of injustice, we who have been formed and collected to be the witnesses of God's agape love, must hear our true calling. Yes, we do many different things by day, but our true calling as students of Jesus is to be shepherds, to nourish, to guide, to guard, to love all creation. Let this be our starting point, dear church, our first task as shepherds, to demonstrate agape love to one another, to be concerned for the well-being of those you don't see in this room today. Willing to think of others besides ourselves, to prioritize world preservation. After all, remember, it is the highest form of love. Choose a faith to love and go be a witness of agape love, for we were made to love and to be loved. I finish with words from the late, great Tina Turner. What's love got to do with it? Well, Miss Turner, apparently everything. We need it. It is a human biological necessity that is divinely summoning the flow that is completing the repair of this world. And we get invited into that flow with our measure of love. Let us go and be agape love in this world. Word of God and word of life, can we say together, thanks be.